Can you hear me, Michael? Henry, can you hear me? I can't hear you.
Yes, that's a yes.
Oh, okay, I got it. For some reason, my start video doesn't work again. Where am I here? Oh, crap. It's always something, you know? It just never fails. I don't know what the problem is.
Will Linda be here tonight? Does anyone know?
What? I assume so.
Yeah. I'm here.
Oh, Chris, yes.
Oh, there you are. There you are. Sorry.
There. Here I am.
There you are.
Oh. Well, we have to do it without seeing my gorgeous face, I guess. Is everybody admitted, want to be admitted? I guess. Bridget. Why am I not on here?
Excuse me, is that Ron or Sue Essick on here? I know it says Ron, but I'd like to know if it's Ron or Sue for the minutes.
I just see Ron.
I know it says Ron, but
I oh, it like is to... Ron.
It's Ron.
Yep.
Okay. Hey, Ron. All right. Thank you. Thank you. Just for the minutes.
Can you still hear me?
Yes.
Okay. We're going to do without the video. I don't know what's going on. It was working fine yesterday. So let's start the meeting. And let me say a few words about why we're having this meeting. Under the Community Preservation Act, towns that make use of that act or have a community preservation committee are required to have a yearly meeting, open meeting to the town. And the idea is that this is a information gathering meeting and we're all here to figure out what the town really needs and what we want to do and to look at the proposals or at least mention the proposals that we have already in hand. And there are three of those. Actually, there's four, but we'll talk about that in a minute. Does anybody have any questions of why we're doing this?
No.
I got two more people waiting, apparently. I don't know who. Okay, Miriam, you there? I don't even see her on the list here.
She's there.
Where?
Miriam is there. She's down at the bottom. You just let her in.
Hello.
I know I did, but I don't see her window. Oh, there she is.
I am here.
There's okay. Somebody. There's
for
somebody
a few minutes.
Yes, that's it. Okay, so there are three proposals for projects that we've received this year. And depending upon the final votes, if they're approved, they will wind up as articles on a town meeting in April. So I guess what I'd like to do is we go through the three proposals and see if there are any questions, anybody has any suggestions or things to do. Does anybody have anything they'd like to see in particular talked about? No. Okay. So,
hello.
Yeah.
Mary Lou. Hi. Yeah, Mary Lou Kanka. Could you identify yourself? Because you only show up on my space as meeting host.
Right. My camera's not working, Mary Lou.
Okay. So are you Al Hansen?
Yeah.
Oh, thank you. Okay.
Yeah. I don't know exactly what's happening here.
Well, this is Janice Stone. I was just wondering, were we able to try to do the historic guide board first, just because a few of us have a CONCOM meeting that starts in half an hour?
Right. So that's what we were going to.
Super. Thank you.
We were going to do. So there are three. There's a property purchase one. There's the Ames Pond proposal, and there's a guidepost proposal. So I'd like to do. Because several people have to leave, I'd like to do the property purchase one first, guidepost second, and Ames Pond project third.
Alan, this is Miriam.
Yep.
Could we just do the historical one first? Because I have to leave in like 10 minutes.
Okay, but you're also involved in the property purchase, right?
Yeah, but I can't stay for that.
And there are two, this is Penny speaking, there are two other people who will be representing that project. So
okay, that's fine with me. We can do the guidepost project first. So this project is asking for, let me find the paperwork here. Here it is. Is to repair the guidepost in the center of town. I don't know if you've been past it, but it's in pretty bad shape. And according to the proposal, the project total is $15,000, and the request is for $10,000 in CPA funds for that project. And basically, do you want to say something about it?
Sure. It's a lot of money because it is a fragile antique. It's was built originally in 1837, I think. And has been repaired and modified over the years, and is listed as a historical structure in the inventory for the Massachusetts Historical Commission. So it's an important historical property for a number of reasons, including and poignantly so that it lists one of the now defunct Quabbin towns, Prescott. Which has been listing since Prescott existed. So there aren't many of these kind of structures around Massachusetts, and so we'd like to preserve it, and it's deteriorating pretty badly. And we would like to get a specialist who can handle it with care and do the best restoration possible.
Okay. So the remainder of the money, as I said, the total project is $15,000. CPA is being asked for $10,000. The rest of it is from a variety of different sources that will make up the total thing. Does anybody have any questions about this particular project? Anything you'd like to ask Miriam or me or the committee or?
I have a question.
Sure, Matthew, what?
So I'm really excited to see this project. Going forward, I did have a question about, and I hope I'm looking at the most up-to-date application, but in section 7 and section 10, which is section 7 is the other funding and section 10 is the maintenance funding, there's a lot of TBD. And I was just wondering if there's any more information about sources of funding for either of those?
Well, the town has not been budgeting any money for any ongoing restoration or maintenance for it. And so, you know, it doesn't require a lot of annual maintenance. What it really needs is regular inspections to make sure it's not damaged and that repairs aren't needed. Hopefully it'll be durable enough that it'll last for a good number of years, that will extend its life with this. The Historical Commission is proposing that either through our donation accounts or other fundraising efforts that might happen in the town, if more repairs need to be done in the future, we would apply for grant money.
Does that answer your question?
It does answer it about the maintenance question. I'm just wondering if any additional funding in Section 7, which is about the current project, it has the Historical Commission down for $5,000, and that's on top of the CPA funds. But I'm wondering if the Friends of the SHC, community donations, or other grant funds has changed all over.
The $5,000 would be inclusive of what we can contribute and any other funds that we get. So our expectation would be that that $5,000 would be a combination of funds, not offsetting the CPA component, but offsetting our funding from the commission, because we don't want to exhaust what funds we have available, because there are other projects that we might be interested in. Sure. And we want to keep that in mind. Going forward, just to answer your question also about maintenance, if we in the future nominate and have the town common or this particular structure listed on the National Register of Historic Places, which is not an impossible feat, we could do that. It takes about 2 years. After that, we can apply for state funds for maintenance costs and future restorations. We're not eligible for those grant monies right now because it's not listed on the National Register. So we don't feel like we can delay this project for 2 or 3 or 4 years, thinking that we can kick the can down the road and look for grant money after we get it listed on the National Register. It's just not going to last that long.
That's great. Thank you.
Are there any other questions?
Yeah, Frank McGinn here. I'm on the Town Buildings Committee. And I know this isn't a building, but we did a review of a bunch of properties recently with Bob Groves. And Bob, we went and looked at the sign, I didn't know the history of it, and he explained the history of it. And I know he had just done some, he was involved in the roof restoration, is that correct?
I think back in 2009, Bob mm-hmm. did some restoration work, and he's expressed an interest in putting in a bid for this particular project. So I think technically he would have to recuse himself from a deliberation on it on the town. Okay. Yeah.
I just was curious about that because he said it needed some paint and a few other things and how important it was.
Yeah, I think he agrees it needs work.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Sure. Anybody else? I've been pushing that they replace that they put Ripton back on the guidepost.
Yeah,
not getting much response though from anybody. So.
No, you're getting it. I'll respond. I think it's a great idea.
Me too. I think it's a great idea.
Good.
Me too.
So we need to start. We need to start a preserve Ripton movement.
Yeah,
for town meeting, there needs to be like preserve Ripton or restore Ripton. I don't know what you want to call it.
We can make a movement out of it.
You could. You should.
Yeah. We can get new town cups, Shutesbury on one side.
We might hit CBS.
That's right. We need it.
We do. Okay. Is there any reason to not move on to the next item?
Thank you.
Before we move on, one of the things I wanted to say before this is that these three projects, as I said, will show up, if they're approved, will show up as articles in town meeting. There's also potentially a fourth article, which doesn't require, which does not involve any expenditure of money, but would give the town the opportunity to move the proposed town garden from behind the townhouse to lot 032, if the library gets moved there. So that will probably also just, what, Elaine?
Not if the library moves there, no matter what.
No matter what, you're going to move it?
We want to move it, yes.
Okay, so that will show up on also as one of the articles from this committee. See, the next thing I had in mind, we were going to do, what did you want to do, Miriam, next? The land purchase? Is Miriam gone?
No, she's there.
We should release Miriam, though.
I'm sorry. Yes, let's do the Pearson land acquisition.
Yes, okay. So you want to start it off? You want to tell us what it's about?
And I'm going to jump off the meeting very quickly after this. So this is a 34 acre property that has been up for sale recently. Came to our attention when Kestrel Land Trust and Jeff Lacey both reached out to us and expressed an interest in seeing it being acquired for conservation land. It's a property that has frontage and potentially could have been developed as housing lots, but it has conservation land value, including significant wetlands, the headwaters of Amethyst Brook. There's a historic mill site on it. And it provides some connectivity and continuity with other preserved open spaces in that area. And is a property that could be easily developed for passive recreation with hiking trails and a parking area. Kestrel Land Trust had a very unique opportunity of some funding available to it that was going to disappear in July of this year from the federal government through the Forest Legacy Program of the Forest Service and U.S. Forest Service. And these funds require a 25% match. Am I right about that?
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
So these funds can only be used for acquiring conservation land with a 25% match. And it's about $210,000, which was a significant amount of the total asking price for this property. Kestrel also was able to raise some other private funds to contribute to offset some of the other expenses related to this. And so we're proposing the acquisition in conjunction with Kestrel, where the town would own the land. The Kestrel funds would be used through this package of funding that Kestrel has in conjunction with a portion of the funds coming from the Conservation Commission's Land Conservation Trust Fund, and then a portion of it coming from CPA. With the total contribution coming to the total match of town funds being, if I'm correct, it's an 88% match, isn't it? Is that the right number?
I think it's 83.
So it's a situation where 83% of the cost is going to be shouldered by other parties, and the town is only going to be required to pay for 17%, which is a very attractive opportunity for acquiring conservation land. We're not going to have this opportunity in the future for other properties, and we haven't purchased any conservation land since 2001.
What is the total cost of the property?
I don't have the.
I've got it somewhere. So the land acquisition cost is $265,000, but the total project cost is $301,000.
Yeah, there's various expenses like the closing costs and the appraisals and other costs for managing the property. And the proposal will be that the town will own it, the Conservation Commission will manage it, and Kestrel Land Trust will hold the conservation restriction for it. The grant proposal or this package includes a proposal for the funding for a gravel driveway, a parking lot, excuse me, on Pelham Hill Road. And then we will develop hiking trails and signage so that people can use it and maybe have maps online as well.
Okay. The number I had, I don't know if this is still right. It was total project cost was $301,400. And the CPA request was $50,000. Does that sound familiar?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm going to sign off, but thank you, everybody.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Miriam.
Okay. Good night.
Does anybody have any questions about on this project? It's a big one.
This is Janice. Can I make a comment?
Sure.
Just that I think this is an excellent opportunity and we really should take advantage of it. We'll never get so much financial help, and it's for a really cool property. It's part of the watershed for the Amherst water supply. And it's a wonderful open space for the town.
Yeah, personally, as just speaking as a resident, I think it's an excellent opportunity. It sits between two protected, can you still hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
So it's telling me now I've been signed out because my account is signed in from another device.
Well, you're still here, Alan.
Yeah, okay. I'll stay here until I'm not. So it's an extension of existing property that I think is going to be a great value to the town and to the environment. There's a lot of interesting animals over in that part of the town.
Hey, I have just a logistical suggestion. If you can do it, do you want to make like Linda a co-host? So if you actually do get bounced out, we won't end the meeting.
Let's see if I can find her. Yeah, make it. Okay. So Linda, you're now a co-host.
Got it.
Does it show up?
Yes.
Okay, yes. Okay,
good. So if I suddenly disappear, you're on.
Okay.
All right. I don't know what's going on. This whole thing has been weird. Okay, so are there any other questions on the property purchase?
Mary Lou Conca has her hand raised.
Thank you, Linda.
I can't even see that.
Oh, gosh. Okay, so I just have a general question. When will you all make the vote to let these proposals go forward? When do we know?
We will vote on these at our next meeting, which is next week, March 17th, I think, or somewhere, plus or minus.
Yes, March 17th.
Yeah. Thank you.
So we'll let everybody know. Well, we'll post it on our webpage anyway, probably. Are there any other questions? Comments? Complaints?
Gail Fleischaker has her hand raised.
You're going to have to do this, Linda, because I can't.
Okay. Okay. Gail?
So I'm wondering if any enthusiasm from out here, namely from the Open Space Committee, would best be registered here or at the next meeting where you're actually going to take a vote?
Gail, this is Penny. I would say that we've already registered our enthusiasm by co-sponsoring the project.
Okay.
And after that, a town meeting.
And then the residents of Shutesbury decide.
Right.
Got it. Thanks.
Alan, I have a question.
Yeah, sorry, Mateo.
I'm going to betray my ignorance of the map here, but is this property contiguous to other lands that are in conservation restriction?
Yes, there are two adjoining.
Thank you.
Pieces.
And it's also across the street from a large portion of Quabbin watershed land. So it's sort of in the middle of already protected land.
Yeah.
Perfect. Thank you.
Anything else? Okay, I guess that's it. I would have expected more questions on this one.
What's the address of the property?
Lot R15.
Thank you.
Yeah, right, R15.
To the corner of Baker Road and Pelham Hill.
And it goes all the way down to the Pelham line.
Is it about any private citizens' properties?
Pardon me?
Is it about any private citizens' properties?
I think the Sirius community is to the west. Mm-hmm. Baker Fields, which is owned by Jeff Lacey, is to the north, but that has a conservation restriction on it already. So most of that property is already protected.
Yeah.
And then across the street is a large area of Quabbin land. And I'm not sure what is the protection on the land in Pelham. Is that Amherst watershed land?
I think it is.
Yes.
Just two private residents.
Frank, if you're asking who owns the property now, Wendy Pearson is the owner and she's selling it.
Okay. I was wondering about adjacent property owners.
Oh. Across the street, yes. But
who are they across the street?
I don't know.
Well, I own some of the property right at the line across the street.
You own a budding property?
Well, it's across the road.
I mean, I just wonder if there's a conflict of interest there. Okay.
For what reason?
I don't know if it adds value to your property to do what you're suggesting.
I'm not suggesting it was proposed. The committee voted on it. I have nothing to say about it.
Like your participation in the process, I just wondered if it amounted to a possible conflict of interest.
Yeah. It couldn't hurt to recuse, but we're not voting tonight, so we can discuss it next week.
I just wanted to mention as an item of concern.
Yeah.
The chair can also disclose. This might be an appropriate one for disclosure. And that often deals with a potential conflict of interest. So you disclose that you have property across the street near the town line, and then you can probably go forward.
Yeah, we'll talk about it.
Noted.
Any other questions, comments? Okay. Let's move on to the Ames Pond. This is a proposal to Chris, you're here. You want to tell us?
Sure.
You do a better job than I will.
Oh, not when I'm this tired, Alan. Yes. So this is a request for the town to fund phase one of a two-phase project to maintain and improve the trails at Ames Pond. Ames Pond was bequeathed to Kestrel Land Trust last year by Julian Janowitz, who spent years creating and maintaining trails and making them available to the public. It was his intention and Kestrel's intention when he bequeathed the property to us that we would maintain that public access. The current trails are in deteriorating condition, particularly the infrastructure. So it's an infrastructure heavy project overall. The overall project cost, including both phases one and two, is $132,000. And we're asking the town to contribute a total of $22,000, which will be focused on improvements to the parking area and the entrance trail to the pond. And a nice aspect of the project that I know you all know about is the improvements that were proposed to protect the entrance meadow, which is wet, are naturally lend themselves to greater accessibility. So we have the opportunity here to create a short accessible trail to a viewing platform. And several of the components in phase two, the bog boardwalk, other water crossings will also need to be accessible, meet accessible standards. And with the rather level trails connecting a lot of those components, we're hopeful that the whole area will be more available to people who might not have walked those trails previously. But the entrance is a sort of a linchpin to that.
There's also going to be a kiosk put up at the end of the trail.
Yep.
Did you mention that?
That's correct. That's actually, that will be funded by the phase two funding. So that won't happen as part of phase one. But we'll continue with temporary signage until we're able to get the funding for the kiosk.
Okay. Any questions, comments? Yeah, it's going to be a great, great improvement to the property. It's going to make it accessible. That's a great walk around there. I don't know if anybody's. I'm sure you've all done it at one point or another. Yeah, Ron then Rita.
Yeah, Alan, thank you. I just wanted to ask a question. Would the lot right now it holds maybe four cars at best. Is the idea to expand the lot any further than that?
Yes. We are uncertain of the exact size right now. We're still in communication with DCR, which holds the conservation. They hold a conservation restriction on a portion of the full property, and the line of the boundary line of that conservation restriction portion is right about where the parking area is. So they wanted to make a determination where that line is, and then they might ask us to try to locate the parking area outside of the CR, which might influence the size. And then I'm also anticipating that potentially the permitting process could influence the size. We wouldn't be planning on more than 3,900 square feet. It's currently about 900.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, I didn't get the first. What are you planning on making it to?
The maximum size that we were considering is 3,900 square feet, which is about 60 by 65 if it were that shape.
Thank you.
Alan?
Yeah.
Frank McGinn has his hand raised, and then Penny Jakes.
Okay, so Frank and then Penny.
Does that mean it would be in the same space? Potentially where there is parking now?
Yes, at least approximately.
And then there's space there to quadruple that or more?
Yeah, interestingly, the backside of, we're hoping, like the way we have planned it, if we were using the exact footprint of the current parking area, the backside of that parking area is a very dense thicket, and most of that is invasive species. So an expansion gives us an opportunity to get rid of those.
Would the parking be along the road or go just back from where it currently is?
It would be at the road.
So it would expand further along the road towards the brook?
It might.
Okay, I'm just trying to picture.
Yeah. And I don't have a plan of it right now.
Are there visuals of it that you would have eventually?
Yes,
Oh, great. Would those, how would we get those?
I'd be happy to provide them to the town. I've actually been in touch with I've reached out to your DPW director. So I'm trying to loop him in. And if there's anybody else that I should loop in, I'm happy to do that. And we'd like to have the town's input if they have any.
Yeah, if you could say, they're not currently in what you sent as a proposal, right?
No, we chose not to because it's so up in the air right now. It didn't seem productive to put speculative sketch plan in there.
Well, as things start to settle down, maybe you could include us in the,
absolutely. That'd be great.
Thanks, Chris.
Presumably by town meeting, you'll have it. So when time to vote, people will
hopefully
have it.
So right now, the next step is DCR and Kestrel staff are meeting up on site to look for boundary markers, which is actually scheduled for March 22nd. So hopefully there won't be any more snow at that point. So we should be able to complete our discussion with DCR fairly soon thereafter. And then it's just a matter of whether we go through the request process with them or avoid the request process with them by placing the parking area outside of the CR. And if we choose to go through the request process with them, that might take a little time. But I would think that we would certainly have our answer from DCR before the town meeting. That's May or June, yes. Right?
So Penny has a question too.
Yep, so Janice is next.
Was Janet first?
Penny was first, then Janice.
I think Penny was first, then Janice.
The previous question asker asked part of my question. I was just trying to wrap my head around the current number of spots and the maximum number you think it might end up being in your best scenario. I was having a hard time with the square feet that you were throwing out and translating that into parking spots.
You mean how many parking spots would that be?
Maximum.
Yeah, the maximum. I think, Penny, it would be about 8 to 12.
Okay. That's all I wanted to know. Thanks very much.
Sure.
As someone who's on the Open Space Committee, I'm so excited about this project. So thanks for putting it forward.
Yeah, it's going to be a great one. Janice, you have a question?
Yes, when Chris is talking about talking to the highway department and stuff, I think you really need to get the Conservation Commission involved as soon as possible, because there's certainly a lot of wetlands, riverfront, rare species, all that stuff from the road on in.
Yep, they're my first stop after I get some answers from DCR.
Okay, good, thanks.
Sure.
Any other questions, comments? I don't see any hands up. Do you?
No.
Okay. No comments.
Oh, and just so you all know, I have been in touch with Miriam about it already.
Good. She told me you had been, so.
Yeah.
Okay. I guess we can call it into the meeting.
Want a motion?
Yes, I do.
I move to adjourn.
Do I hear a second?
I second. That was me, Elaine.
We should vote. Hanson, aye.
Linda, Farrell, aye.
Vallejo, aye.
Geddes, aye.
Gott, aye.
DeCiera, aye.
And Gallo, aye.
Well, it's unanimous.
We're done. Great, great meeting.
Thank you all for showing up.
Thanks. Good night.
Thanks, good night. Everyone.
So you're in somewhere, Rita, right? In I guess she hung up.